Is this where you want me to sit?
Yes, please. Let's see.
Well, here we go.
Thank you again for agreeing to see me, Dr. Shannon. This is an amazing room.
I guess you must seem pretty funny. A grown man has a room full of toys. My life's work.
I don't think you need to worry about just being remembered for your toys.
Claude doesn't overly worry about how he'll be remembered.
No. How do you uncover me again, Michelle?
As I said on the phone, I'm working on a project about the founders of the modern age. And I kept seeing over and over again Claude Shannon, the father of information theory. But nobody seemed to know what you're doing now. Your 1948 paper was a blueprint for what people are calling the information age.
I wrote that nearly 40 years ago.
Yes. In a sense, you saw the future. How did you do that?
How long do you plan on being here?
Maybe I should get some coffee.
All right. Now, the fact is, Michelle, that my mind wanders around and conceives of different things day and night. And like a science fiction writer, I think. What if it were like this? And I never particularly cared whether anybody was interested in it or wanted to work on it or thought I was right. Do you want to see the first wearable computer?
Okay.
I built this with Ed Thorpe, who was a professor here at MIT. Ed had a paper he wanted to get published about blackjack in the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. And since I was the only member of the Academy at the time at MIT, he asked for my help. We got to talking, and it turns out he had some pretty interesting ideas about roulette, too. Our little computer could time the speed of the wheel and the speed of the ball in the other direction. It's a simple dynamic system with very little friction. We discovered that nearly all roulette tables are slightly tilted, so we could predict 2/3 of the time which half of the wheel the ball would fall in. The computer would be in my pocket, and these little wires would run down my pant leg into my shoes, and there was a little switch in there that I operated with my big toe. And then these went up to a little loudspeaker in my ear. And the computer would send one of the 8 musical notes of the scale to mark the octants in the wheel. Ed had a little loudspeaker in his ear, too. And I operated the computer, and Ed placed the bets and pretended he didn't know me. But we had some practical problems when we got to Las Vegas. The wires going down my pant leg kept shorting and giving me little shocks.
And Ed's speaker fell out of his ear, and he nearly scared this lady to death because she thought it was some alien insect. We were lucky. We didn't get arrested.
Hello, I'm Claude Shannon, a mathematician here at the Bell Telephone Laboratories. This is Theseus. Theseus is an electrically controlled mouse. He has the ability to solve a certain class of problems by trial and error means and then remember the solution. In other words, he can learn from experience. Like his classical namesake, Theseus has the problem of finding his way through a maze.
The mouse moves by this electromagnet, and its brain are these switches, just like the switches you'd find in a telephone switchboard. Betty did most of the wiring, by the way. I took it over to Bell Labs one day and, to show them. They liked it very much. They were very impressed, and they even wanted to use it in a film.
When did you build this? It must have been one of the earliest artificial intelligence devices.
Betty! When did we make Theseus?
1950. He made a little turtle First, that would walk around the house and bump into things and back off. And then the mouse.
So you said that you did most of your information theory work between 1943 and 1945. So why didn't you publish your paper until 1948?
Laziness, I guess. I have a number of papers that are unpublished. They're even more tardy than that.
Well, we've got boxes and boxes of unfinished papers upstairs. Who knows what's in them? Maybe we should punish you and make you go through them.
Well, I never liked writing very much. I liked ideas, but was lazy about putting them down on paper, which is how you get the acclaim. Mm.
After we were married, he would dictate his papers to me, and I would write them up.
You were a mathematician at Bell Labs, too, right?
I married a computer. I have a lot of things I like to spend time on. The intelligent machine idea is my big interest now. The transformation of information that a human brain does, not just the transmission. How the brain works, or doesn't. I think that's the biggest challenge now. Simulating the human brain. Alan Turing and I often had lunch together, and we'd talk about if you could get a computer the equivalent of a brain, a human brain, or even a lot better. I wrote a paper about how a computer could play chess. I have a standing bet that the computer will beat the grand champion by 2001.
What do you think about the idea that a machine might one day outthink a human?
Well, I'm rooting for the machines.
But do you think a machine would ever come up with the idea of a flaming trumpet?
No, I think that creative stuff is a long ways off. But in the meantime, they can be a boon to humanity. And I'd like to see that happen as soon as possible.
I heard that one of your last papers proved that you could make a reliable circuit from faulty components. Do you think that this might have applications for the brain?
I hope so. I mean, the brain can suffer all kinds of damage and still handle things pretty well, which means there must be redundancy. The fact that the brain has 10 billion neurons probably means that it was cheaper for biology to just make more components than to figure out sophisticated circuits. Trying to work out all the different connections would be astronomical, impossible. But if we can find patterns, well, there may be ways to simplify things. Juggling relates to patterns. There's a topology and a combinatorial aspect. I wrote a paper for Scientific American. No, come on, Mr. Fields. Well, I came up with a formula for juggling that relates the number of balls you're juggling to how long each is in the air versus in the hand.
Did you ever think about commercializing your inventions?
Oh, fiddle, we don't believe in commercializing fun.
You didn't worry that they might not be practical?
Well, that'd be the last thing. I built a lot of useless gadgets just because they're fun to make. I'm more interested in, is this an interesting problem? Is it an elegant problem? I get a big bang out of proving a theory or seeing a clever way to do something. I make my money in the stock market, not by proving theorems.
You play the stock market? You're interested in making money?
Oh, sure, aren't you?
Well, it's just... Were you ever successful?
Beyond reasonable expectations.
I even did some work on the theory of stocks. In a certain way, it's like channel capacity in a noisy channel.
You found that you could apply information theory to the stock market.
Inside information.
We had good friends who started good companies.
The bottom line is that theories aren't as important as products or people.
All the things he built were very practical. His maze, a toy, yes, but it was a toy that illustrated some very interesting things. his chess playing machine. Again, a toy, but artificial intelligence people just learned so many things from that, and it was highly useful. His cryptography during the Second World War, the fact that it wasn't very practical then, is almost irrelevant. He still wrote the best paper on cryptography that's been written yet. Practical or playful? It's a silly question in most cases. He was into understanding.
Wow.
My ultimate machine. You know what Fats Waller said about swing music, don't you, Michelle?
Oh, no.
Either you got it or you ain't.